on your mic and tell me what are the 4 M's.
Men,
what are the 4 M's? Man, yeah.
Material, management, machinery.
Material, management, money and machinery. Not management. It is material, manage, money, machine and money. Money, material, machine and man are the 4 M's that are managed by the management. So here once it's know how many number it will be able to sell, that is known as demand forecasting. And how many units will the company able to sell in 1 year, so that it plans its raw material, it plans its finance, it plans its human resources, that is the employees, and it plans its machinery capacity. So for which it is important to estimate the demand forecasting. And what do you mean by demand analysis? Analyzing the demand, analysis of the demand. What do you mean by analysis? It's nothing but what are the factors that influence the demand and how does it affect the demand? Like for example, price of a commodity, price of the product will affect the demand or not? As we have law of demand, what is the in impact of change in advertisement, in change in quantity demanded. Change in advertisement and change in quantity demanded are positively related. What happens if the advertisement increases? What happens if the advertisement increases? Will the sales increase or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so advertisement and sales are positively related. So such relation would be easily identified and it will impact of demand analysis and the determinants of demand would be estimated to know what is the impact of change in price. What is the impact of change in advertisement? What is the impact of change in income of employees? Income, even income has impact on demand. Why? Because, for example, if the prices go up, simultaneously if the income also grows up, will it have impact or not? Yes, definitely it will have impact on increase in income. The next important thing in demand analysis is change in related goods, change in related goods. What are the two related goods that have impact on demand? I've told that related goods are classified into two. What are those two? One is, what do you mean by related goods? Impact of change in price of related goods have impact on quantity demanded or sales. What do you mean by related goods? Anyone in the class, the whole class, CSE D section? Related goods constitutes two. What are those two? One is substitute, one is complementary. Very bad, Nana. You forgot this? And what example I gave you in the case of substitutes? In the case of substitutes, what example I gave? Tea or coffee. Isn't it? Do you remember now? And what is the example that I gave you in the case of complementary? One we go with that of the other, such as sugar and tea, milk and tea. If the prices of sugar goes up, the demand for tea comes down. Complementary. This is known as complementary. And what do you mean by substitutes? This or that. Tea or coffee. So if the prices of tea goes up, the demand for coffee goes up. So these are positively related. If the prices of sugar goes up, the demand for tea comes down. These are negatively related. So always remember, the substitutes are positively related. The demand for complementary goods are negatively related. This we do in the second unit, demand analysis. So this is where we apply the concept of business economics. Nana, are you following? Are all there in the class or sleeping still? Are you following, all of you? We are in the scope of business economics. The first point, demand analysis and forecasting. Is this clear? Yeah. So as I said, I'm not again shifting my screen, Nana. Please on your mic. ఇది నేను మీకు ఒక ఎన్ని టైమ్స్ చెప్పాను మళ్ళీ చెప్తున్నాను. I have to shift over because you know Google Meet లో if I am on the screen, I have to shift over to the screen and see your answers. Rather on your mic and respond whenever I ask a question. It's not mere asking you to just sing a song, isn't it? So that your voice would come out. It's just an answer on your mic, answer then off your mic. Is this clear? Now, going to the second point, cost-benefit analysis. The second point where we apply the business economics is cost-benefit analysis. So here each and every management try to analyze what is the cost incurred to manufacture a product, what is the benefit that we are getting. So cost is nothing but the total cost, benefit is nothing but the profit that the company is getting by producing a product or rendering a service. Each and every aspect would be analyzed based on cost benefit analysis. It even analyzes by appointing a particular employee. By appointing a particular employee, what is the cost that we are incurring by appointing a particular employee? What do you mean by cost of an employee? It's nothing but a salary, isn't it? Salary that the company will pay to an employee is the cost, and what is the benefit that he derived to the company? That is increase in profit. Increase in profit, increase in turnover is what the company try to analyze. Is it beneficial by appointing a particular person or is it a loss to the company? So that's what we say it is cost benefit analysis, analyzed in each and every aspect, even in case of HR, that is an employee. Now going to the pricing policy and practice decisions. Pricing, as I said, how important is the pricing decision taken by the management? As underpricing is a danger to the company and overpricing is also a danger to the company. So there are few techniques or methods of pricing given in business economics, classified into cost-based pricing, demand-based pricing, competition-based pricing and strategy-based pricing. Under each method, we have again different methods. So these are basically classified into four methods. Four methods, that is demand-based, cost-based, competition-based and strategy-based. So based on which is suitable to the company, the organization will adopt that particular method of pricing. So business economics will... Yes? Someone has on your mic? Anna, any doubt? So the company try to analyze which method would be apt to that particular product, will be adopting such method for pricing. The next one is profit maximization. As I said, profit maximization technique is nothing but increase in the profits. So this is what one of the theory given by which author? Who has supported this theory? The first theory in theory of firm. Theory of firm.
Fredman.
Yeah, Fredman is a person who have supported this concept of profit maximization. So here the concept is one golden rule of the business is for the person who risks the time, effort and money will reap the profits. The basic motive or objective of the firm is profit maximization. And one of the tool that is applied to estimate profit is break-even analysis. Do you remember, Nana, break-even analysis? What do you mean by break-even analysis? It is a point which is calculated by applying the formula. How many units should I sell so that I'll be in a break-even? Break even is a point where TR is equal to TC. What is TR? TR is total revenue. What is TC? TC is total cost. This is a point where the firm would be at no profit, no loss. Any one unit sold beyond the break even is profit. So the company calculates break even point to analyze how many units should I sell so that I would be in a profit zone. Any unit less than break even is a loss. So what is the technique that we apply to plan profits? Break even analysis. Break even. As I said, when we start up a new business, initially TR would be less than TC. Then as we increase the advertising efforts and work more hard, TR becomes equal to TC. Then still we put more effort on advertising and promoting the product, then TR would be more than TC. This is a point where profits would be starting for the business. So this is known as profit maximization. Now wealth maximization, it's not just profits, the total wealth of the company. Wealth referred to wherever the concept of money comes, wherever the concept of wealth comes. Each and every company try to manage such as capital, such as profits, such as investment, such as wealth assets and so on. Now coming to the next one, capital management. So basically the sources of capital are classified into two. What are those? Conventional and non-conventional. Conventional ante long-term, non-conventional ante two. That is mid-term and short-term. So basically it is classified into four, isn't it? Now, how do company raise capital? What are those four? Anyone in the class? Don't type on your mic and tell me. How do company raise capital? How do companies raise capital, Nana? By issuing shares. Very good. By issuing shares. Shares are of two types. What are those? Preference shares and equity shares. Second one is by issuing debentures. The third one is raising loans, short term and mid term. Then the last one is own funds. That is through own pocket. This is what how the company raise capital. So how efficiently will you manage the capital? Why? Because how much do you have share capital? How much you have debentures? How much do you have loans? How much do you have? One is investment decision or capital budgeting. If the project is of more than 1 year, then we take the help of what? We take the help of? To analyze the profits, if the project is for more than 1 year, we calculate with the help of capital budgeting techniques, that is time value of money. We convert present for profits. Do you remember, Nana? Present profits in the future. Calculation of present value of future profits now is known as time value of money. We convert what would be this 1 lakh after 5 years to decide whether to invest in that project or not. Isn't it? So that is known as investment decision. Then budget preparation. What do you mean by budget? Budget is nothing but estimation of cost. Isn't it? And each and every manager try to be under the budget, not going beyond the budget, isn't it? Budget is nothing but estimation of cost in each area. So that each and every manager try to be in that purview only. If the cost is crossing the budget, we say it is adverse effect. If the cost is within the budget limit, then we say favorable. Then decision of sources of finance, that's what I said. How to select which source of finance, then marketing decision, how to promote the product, what is the various, is it a media, is it a television, is it a newspaper or is it what that we apply to promote our product, because the different media supply different sources of marketing in order to attract the consumers and retain the existing consumers. So like for example, most of the companies try to advertise TV, as television is the main media to have communication with the consumers. So they prefer such. Then going to the next one, production decision. A production decision refer to which product gives more profits, what is the product mix that to be decided and so on. Then make or buy decision. This is what I have already told you. The important decision taken by the management. What do you mean by make or buy decision? Can anyone say what was the example that I gave you? Make or buy decision taken by the management. What was the example that I have used to explain make or buy decision? I gave you an example of an automobile where a company manufactures an automobile and it requires tube tires. So it has two options, whether to make in its own factory or buy from outside by going and giving an order to outsourcing, isn't it? This is what the example that I gave you. So important decision taken by the management to make it in its own factory or buy from outside. If it wants to make in its own factory, whether it requires to buy a machinery, set up a unit, or set up a total branch, based on which it's better to go for buying, or it's is it better to go for making in its own factory. Now going to the next one, inventory management. What do you mean by inventory? Inventory refer to stock. Stock refer to the company's stock that it has in the business. Stock here refer to the final products or the products that it deals with. So there are four methods: LIFO method, FIFO method, weighted average method, and simple average method. So which method is more easy for it? It will adopt that method. So you need not worry what are the four methods and so on. So selection of inventory management will also be helped with the business economics. So inventory and the stock that it has, how to maintain the stock, how to issue the stock, how to maintain the stock is known as inventory management system. So even business economics helps it out. So this is all about scope of business economics. Any doubts in this? Nana, respond. Are you there? I see 51 in the
no,
room.
Ma'am.
Nana, enduku nana inta ivalu inta arpistunnaru andaru evvaru respond avvatledu? What's the reason? The next one is significance. Significance can be again derived from the same how it is applicable and how is it important. The same points that have been again repeated here. It helps the management in what way is what it has been given again. So you can write on your own again. Just have a look at the PPT which I'll forward you. So this is what the significance of business economics. Significance, it's nothing but the importance of business economics in the business. So once you have studied the nature and scope, you can write on your own how important in the business economics in the business. Now going to the next one, a role of a business economist in the business. So who is a business economist? The business economist is nothing but the finance manager in the business. So how should he help the business in the manage to the management? He is known as the role of business economist. And finance manager is a person who plays the role of business economist. As I said, the organization is divided into various functions performed. As finance is the backbone, or how important is the finance? It's important as a flowing blood in a human body, how important it is. The same way, finance is also playing a very important role in the business. So therefore, what is the role of a business economist? So a business economist should help in estimation of demand and forecasting, preparation of sales forecasting, and market survey. What do you mean by market survey? It's nothing but again demand forecasting. What like market survey is nothing but, is there any change in the taste and preferences of the consumers due to change in the technology or change in fashion or change in the technology? Is the change in fashion, taste and preferences of the consumers has happened in the market or not? Why? Because we need to study this to analyze the demand. If there is no preferences given to our product, whatever you market, how much you advertise, they don't buy your product, isn't it? So a continuous survey of market is what very important. Like now, who will purchase a semi-automatic washing machine? Because everyone is now tuned with that of a fully automatic washing machine. So how much you advertise, how much you give offers, how much you try to convince the consumer, they don't prefer semi-automatic washing machine. Why? Because the technology have been changed. So people prefer fully automatic. The same way even the cell phones, isn't it? How many of you will now use keypad when you have an option of smartphones, isn't it? So market survey is what very important. Is any company introducing a new product so that the consumers are going there, isn't it? Like how can we compare an Activa with that of a scooter, a gearless without gear? There is no comparison at all. If you give how much of discounts, how much of benefits, or how much of exchange offers, still people don't prefer, because this is due to change in taste and preferences of the consumers due to change in technology. So market survey plays a very important role. How fast are the taste and preferences of the consumers changing with the change in the technology? Now, issue all the problems related to the industry should also be discussed. Like, for example, any new policy taken by the government under the industrial policy, how is that impact on the company should also be analyzed. Then business planning, then advising, pricing, investment and capital budgeting. Then building micro and macroeconomics. Now let me listen. What do you mean by microeconomics, Nana, which we have done in the last class? Micro ante aspects related to
short firm.
Yeah, a single firm, such as pricing decision, profit decision, production decision, investment decision. All the decisions relating to a single firm is known as microeconomics. And what do you mean by macroeconomics?
Related to economy of a country.
Very good. Related to economy of a country, one country, such as national income, GDP, taxation, industrial policies, and all the affairs relate to a one particular economy of a country is known as macroeconomics. So building various models is the role of business economists. Then economic research. What do you mean by economic research? Market research. Or how do you reduce your cost by doing various research? How efficiently will you manage your cost? Why? Because if you reduce the cost, ultimately you will increase the profit. So various research activities would be done to reduce the cost and increase the profit. And briefing the management on current domestic and global economic issues and emerging challenges. So here, as you know, what is the current situation in our country, isn't it, in India? How is the country facing the economic issues with this pandemic, where there is a shortage of medicine, there is a shortage of oxygen, there is a shortage of even vaccines, isn't it? As the virus have been spreading so drastically, the demand of vaccine have increased, where the supply can't meet the demand, isn't it? In spite, the government have given many subsidies in millions, isn't it? So that to improve the production, to increase the production and try to meet the demand with that of supply. But still, we observe, we see so many people dying without the medicine, the injection that is required, that is Remdesivir and Cofever, isn't it? Covin fever, some injection required, isn't it? So these are all having shortage. Why? Because of the current pandemic situation. The next one is other economic activities related to the business should be advised by a business economist. So this is one of the important questions. Define business economics. Give its nature and scope is what we have done. What do you mean by importance of business economics or significance of business economics? The role of business economics in the business. So this is what I'll share you, the PPT as well as the PDF of this. Now going to the last in the business economics, multidisciplinary nature of business economics. What do you mean by what do you mean by multidisciplinary nature is this point is also there in the scope of business economics. Multidisciplinary ante, well, while we study the business economics, it's not that subject alone, but we involve many subjects to study business economics. What are the other subjects that we involve? Like PGDBM, the business school, B school students have this as a separate subjects, production management as a specialization, information technology as a specialization, HR as a specialization, FM, financial management as a specialization. So business economics is not just the economics that we study, but we involve many subjects, isn't it? So such as production management, how efficiently can we manage and control the production? Marketing management, how do we market the product by pricing, by cost and value chain analysis? Then financial management, how do we acquire capital? How do we maintain capital? Then human resources, it's nothing but how do the company manage the human resources? How do it manage performance management? It's very important that you hire a talented management, talented people, but how do you manage their performance? How do you get best of the employees is known as performance management. That is also studied in business economics. Then operations research. You have like earlier people, even BTech students have used to have this subject as OR. Operations research helps to study the relationship between how the decisions in the business taken when the problems are faced related to queuing, relating to analysis of data and so on. Then mathematics is involved in calculations, how to calculate cost, how to calculate profit, how to calculate increase in cost. Incremental cost is nothing but increase in cost due to increase in production. So all such would be analyzed with the help of mathematical calculation. Then statistics helps to forecast the demand, condensing the data, correlation and regression. How are various variables, demand analysis related? Correlation is whether they are positivity related or negativity related is known as correlation. Like how price and sales are negatively related, income and sales are positively related, advertisement and sales are positively related. Such would be helped with correlation and regression. Then computer science, we have many accounting packages. We have many programs which helps us to manage the stock, inventory referred to stock, then supply and demand prediction and so on. So this is what the concept of multidisciplinary nature of business economics and multidisciplinary concept. So we have done with the concepts of nature, scope, role of business economics, significance of business economics, multidisciplinary nature of business economics. So any doubts still here? I'm going a bit fast as we are lagging, Nana, especially my sections A and D, we are lagging a lot. So therefore, I'm a bit fast. So anywhere, if you have any doubts, you can stop me and ask me. But as of, is it clear till now? I'll go with the national income, the next concept. Do you have any doubts till here? Is it clear?
Clear.
No?
Clear.
Yeah. All of you? Yes, is it with all? Shall I go with the national income, the next concept? Only Abhinav has asked. So Teja, Surya Teja, clear? Okay, Shravya. 572. And if you are not following, please let me know. If not, I'll just proceed with it. So please respond. Only 451 have on the mic, the remaining have just typed. What about the others? Huh? CR, shall I proceed then? So national income is what the next concept you have. In national income, you have, what do you mean by national income? Concepts of national income and measurement of national income. So this is what we have in the concept of national income. Who has come now to the class? At 9:38, 9:40. So now national income is what the next concept. So as each and every aspect of a country is related with the national income, isn't it? The total economy of a country depends upon the national income. So national income is nothing but the value of final output of all the new goods and services produced in 1 year of a country is known as national income. Is that clear? All the new goods or the final products or the final output of goods. Goods refer to what, Nana? What do you mean by goods here? Goods refer to? The products manufactured or produced is known as goods. And what do you mean by services? What do you mean by services? Services refer to?
Hospital services, example.
In Nana? Yeah, very good. Hospitals, education, insurance, banking, brokerage, all these constitutes services. So services, hospitals also known as services, education institutions, all these are known as services. So therefore, services value in money, goods is produced and manufactured in money is known as, in 1 year of a country, is known as national income. And the formula for net national income, NNI, net national income is equal to consumption. What do you mean by consumption? Consumption is nothing but utilizing. How do the people use goods and services is known as consumption plus investment. The money earned by an individual will either consume it by purchasing a product or a service or by investment. Investment in savings or in businesses is known as investment. So C plus I, investment, plus government, government spending. What do you mean by government spending? It's nothing but the government expenditure. The government expenditure refer to government provides us a civilized society, which incurs most cost, isn't it? So whatever the cost that incur is known as government expenditure. So the total of net national income is equal to consumption of the individuals, investment of the individuals, government expenditure, net exports. How do you calculate net exports? Net exports is equal to exports minus imports. What do you mean by exports, Nana? What do you mean by exports?
Exporting out of the country.
Yeah, anything sending outside the country is known as exports. Anything bringing from outside is known as imports. And net exports is equal to exports minus imports. We arrive at net exports. Then the next one is NFF, net factor income from abroad, or net foreign income from abroad is known as NFF. What do you mean by this? It's nothing but Indian nationals, Indian companies having foreign branches, the income earned through such foreign branches is known as NFF. What we say it as net foreign income from abroad. Minus IT, IT referred to indirect taxes. What do you mean by indirect taxes? We have two indirect taxes. What are the two indirect taxes in India, present regime? We have
GST, custom duty and...
That's it, Nana. GST and customs duty. Goods and services tax and customs duty. Earlier, we have so many. Sales tax, service tax, value added tax. Okay. And we have excise duty. Like this, we have many indirect taxes. But everything have now bought in one umbrella. That is known as goods and services tax plus customs duty. Customs have two, imports and exports. As I said, everything is exempted if you export except two items. What are those two items? Nana, anyone in the class? Whatever you send outside India is fully exempted. Inka exemption kaakunda, governments give you many, many, many benefits in order to have balance with imports and exports. As we have more of imports, not only it gives exemption in exports, but it also provides concessional rate of interest. It provides free tax holiday benefit, no tax on profits at all. As you know, corporate rate of tax is 24%. So you need not pay any tax on anything. So what are the two things? What is skins and hides of live animals and live animals? Except these two, everything is exempted, I said, isn't it? And which rates of duties are very high? Import duty or export duty?
Export.
Import. I gave you example of what? A car, isn't it? A car, brand new car, 100%. A car 3 months old, 130%. Then a car older than 3 months is not allowed to bring inside India. So therefore, to safeguard the local and indigenous companies, this is what high rates of import duties. So indirect taxes would be deducted, and depreciation. Depreciation is nothing but depletion in the value of the asset. The assets which have assets under machinery or furniture or whatever used in the business, if it's become out of fashion, if it becomes not able to use, such is known as depreciation. So if you remove depreciation, you will get net national income. Did you understand the formula? How do we calculate? Yeah, Nana.
That taxes are related to only India or in general you are telling?
Nana, idi India de, ni cheppinanta India de. As we are Indians, I'm talking about national income of India. This is how we calculate. Or any other country, the formula is same, but the tax regime is different in different countries. International taxation is totally different with our Indian Taxation Act 1961. We have taxes divided into two, direct taxes and indirect taxes. Direct taxes lo wealth tax okati, property tax or wealth tax, and the one is income tax. Indirect taxes lo rendu, GST okati, customs okati. Is it clear, Nana? This is how we arrive at national income of a country. Any doubts? Shall we move on? Components of national income or concepts of national income? Shall I proceed, Nana? Any yes, doubts in any concept here?
No.
Formula?
Yes.
Yeah. Now going to the features of national income. National income is a macroeconomic concept. It is nothing but the realization of flow of goods and services and a final value of goods and services in one country in 1 year. Then it includes all goods and services produced. It's a monetary value. It's nothing but a monetary value. Then it includes final goods. Final only intermediaries value cheyyaru. While they calculate the national income, intermediaries or raw material will not be considered. If it is considered, it would be double counting. Only the final product that would be valued. What do you mean by final product? Like for example, a refill and a pen. A refill is a final product for one company. A pen is a final product for the other company. And refill is a raw material for the pen manufacturing company. So refill will not be counted. Only the pen will be counted, as pen is the final product. The same way manufacturing of a furniture. Manufacturing of a decorum, manufacturing of a take wood is not valued, but only the furniture value would be valued. If it valued the decorum, if it valued the take, again the final product includes these two, cost of all these, isn't it? So therefore it leads to double counting. Only the value of a take wood furniture would be valued, but not the value of decorum or the take wood used. It includes the labor cost, everything, and the final product of a take wood furniture produced in a country in 1 year would be valued. Did you follow, Nana? This is what final goods and services. Ardhamainda? Financial year. The last one is a financial year. What is a financial year? When does it start? And when does it end?
April 1st to March 31st.
Yeah, April 1st to March 31st. 1 year lo oka country, how many they value, how many they produce, how many they render services, monetary value, final product of all these would be known as national income. And why is it important to study national income? The national income helps to know the size of economy. Based on the size of economy, the country would be determined whether it's a developed country or developing country. Trends in economic growth, like for example, national income is one of the source as to measure, is the country going in profit wise or is it in loss wise, comparison with the past year with that of this year, or comparison with the developing countries with that of developed countries, or plan the sectors where the country is lacking, which sector is giving more profits, which sector is giving less. Is it service lo kuda which sector, is it production products lo kuda which is giving more, agriculture industry, a small scale industry, large scale industry, is it fishing, is it mining, which sector is below, which sector is above the expectations, to formulate government policies. Weaker sectors ki subsidies ivadam, help cheyadam, or giving more budget to that particular sector to formulate policies, national income plays a very important role. So this is what the concept of importance of national income. We have studied what do you mean by national income, how is national income arrived at, net national income, then importance, and the next one is features, importance, now concepts. Concepts and how do you arrive at national income. So the first one is, these are the concepts of national income. The first one is GDP. GDP refer to gross domestic product at market price. Market price or at factor cost is known as GDP. Is that clear? Factor cost refer to, it includes cost of production plus profit. Or market price refer to at what price are they offered in the market. So gross domestic product refer to in 1 year, one country, final product's value of monies in producing goods and services is known as GDP. Is it clear? This is known as one measure of national income, as a concept of national income. And how do I arrive at net domestic product? Net domestic product refer to GDP at factor cost or at market price minus depreciation. Depreciation, as I said, unused machinery, unused value of goods, or unused value of technology, the obsolete machinery which is out or not used, or the decrease in the value of asset due to usage is known as depreciation. So if you deduct depreciation from GDP, you will get net domestic product. GDP, the next one is NDP. GDP minus depreciation is NDP. And what is depreciation? Depletion in the value of the asset. Now what is GNP? GNP is nothing but GDP is exclusion of net factor income from abroad. Is that clear, Nana? What is the difference between GDP and GNP? GDP excludes net factor income from abroad. But in the case of GNP, GNP includes not only GDP but plus net factor income from abroad. What do you mean by net factor income from abroad? Indian nationals earning income abroad, or Indian companies having branches outside. The income earned through these is known as net factor income from abroad. So if you add this to GDP, you get GNP. Then GNP minus depreciation is NNP, net national product. Okay, now personal income. Personal income is another national income concept. What are the sources of income of an individual, Nana? I have told you. All the sources of income of all Indian nationals is known as personal income. So basically, sources of income is classified into five heads. What are those? Taxation load, total income raadanki, they are classified into five sources of income. What are those?
Income from salary.
Very good. Income from salary.
Income from house.
Income from house property. Very good. Third one.
Income from profession.
Business or profession.
Capital gain.
Capital gain. Very good. And what do you mean by capital gain, Nana? Capital gain ante enti?
Investing.
Very good. When you purchase a plot, when you purchase a house, or when you purchase anything, you possess it for 3 years, then sale. The difference between the sale price and purchase price is known as capital gain, which attracts capital gain tax. లాస్ట్ ఏంటి ఇన్కమ్ ఫ్రమ్
అదర్ సోర్స్
ఇట్ ఈస్ ఆల్సో నోన్ యాజ్ రెసిడ్యువల్ సోర్స్ ఏవైతే విచ్ డజంట్ ఫాల్ ఇన్ ది ఫస్ట్ ఫోర్ హెడ్స్ విల్ ఫాల్ ఇన్ ది అదర్ లాస్ట్ హెడ్ ఎగ్జాంపుల్ ఇంట్రెస్ట్ ఆన్ లోన్ ఇంట్రెస్ట్ ఆన్ డిబెంచర్స్ డివిడెండ్స్ ఇవన్నీ కూడా ఆర్ రెంట్ రెంటల్ ఇన్కమ్ ఆన్ సబ్లెటింగ్ సబ్లెటింగ్ అంటే రెంట్ టెనెంట్ మళ్ళీ ఇంకొకరికి టెనెంట్ కి ఇస్తే దట్ ఈస్ నోన్ యాజ్ ఇన్కమ్ ఫ్రమ్ సబ్లెటింగ్ నార్మలీ ఇఫ్ యూ ఓనర్ గివ్స్ టు ఎన్ టెనెంట్ దెన్ ఇట్ ఈస్ ఇన్కమ్ ఫ్రమ్ హౌస్ ప్రాపర్టీ ఇన్కమ్ ఫ్రమ్ సబ్లెటింగ్ ఈస్ ఇన్కమ్ ఫ్రమ్ అదర్ సోర్సెస్ సో దిస్ ఈస్ హౌ వెన్ వీ అరైవ్ ఎట్ ఆల్ ది సోర్సెస్ ఆఫ్ ఇన్కమ్ ఆఫ్ ఎన్ ఇండివిజువల్ దట్ ఈస్ నోన్ యాజ్ పర్సనల్ ఇన్కమ్ బిఫోర్ పేమెంట్ ఆఫ్ ట్యాక్స్ ఈస్ నోన్ యాజ్ personal income okay and how is it calculated private income ante individuals private income minus undistributed corporate profits as I said if it meets all the commitments the balance would be transferred to retained earnings account so such would be deducted minus profit taxes so then we will arrive at personal income పర్సనల్ ఇన్కమ్ అంటే యాడింగ్ ఆల్ ది ఇండివిజువల్స్ ఆల్ హెడ్స్ ఆఫ్ ఇన్కమ్స్ దట్ ఈస్ నోన్ యాజ్ పర్సనల్ ఇన్కమ్ ప్రైవేట్ ఇన్కమ్ మైనస్ అన్డిస్ట్రిబ్యూటెడ్ కార్పొరేట్ ప్రాఫిట్స్ మైనస్ ప్రాఫిట్ ట్యాక్సెస్ ప్రాఫిట్ ట్యాక్సెస్ ఇస్ నథింగ్ బట్ ది డైరెక్ట్ ట్యాక్సెస్ ద నెక్స్ట్ కాన్సెప్ట్ ఇస్ పర్సనల్ డిస్పోజబుల్ ఇన్కమ్ పర్సనల్ డిస్పోజబుల్ ఇన్కమ్ రెఫర్ టు పర్సనల్ ఇన్కమ్ మైనస్ డైరెక్ట్ ట్యాక్సెస్ వాట్ ఆర్ ది డైరెక్ట్ ట్యాక్సెస్ దట్ వీ హ్యావ్
Income tax.
Very good. Income tax and wealth tax, isn't it? Income tax is the tax imposed on the income earned. If you are based on the statutes, there are four statutes or types of businesses. Individual, partnership, individual and sole trader, partners, company, cooperative societies, isn't it? So therefore, personal disposable income is nothing but money ready in the hands of the consumers to spend is known as personal disposable income income minus taxes is personal disposable income it's nothing but ready in the hands of the individuals to spend is known as personal disposable income so this is what the concept of national income then real income ante entante as I said every year the value of rupee comes down So here real income would be calculated based on compensating the value of rupee. So every year RBI provides us index numbers. Every year RBI provides index numbers. What do you mean by index numbers? Index numbers concept have been started in the year 1961 to compensate the rupee value. Okay, index number is nothing but the numbers provided by the RBI to compensate the value of rupee. Okay, so the current index number is 301. First one 60 in the year 1961 nunchi 100 nunchi start ayyindana. Now the number is 301 for the financial year 2021. Last year it was 289, but the before year it was 280. So here, how do we apply or how do we calculate the real income is NNP, net national income. NNP, how do we arrive at NNP? GDP, nunchi GNP. GDP ki if we add net national income from abroad, we get GNP. GNP minus depreciation, we get NNP. Isn't it? NNP of current year into base year index. What is our base year index? 289 divided by current year index that is 301 we get real income is that clear indexes endukante every year rupee value padipothundi to compensate the rupee value we apply this indices these index numbers are given by the RBI every year which would be changing it has first started in 1961 with 100 which is now 301 in the year 2021 did you follow nana Yes, did you yes, follow ma'am. What do you mean by real income? NNP is, you have followed, how do we calculate NNP? NNP lo nunchi real income is nothing but NNP of current year into base year index number. Base year index number given by RBI is 289 and current year index number is 301. So in whatever would be the amount in NNP into base year divided by current year index, we get real income. Now going to the last concept, per capita income. Per capita income is equal to total income divided by total population. Total income divided by total population is known as per capita income. This helps us to know how is per unit individual's income is. Is it clear, Nana? Total population, total income divided by total population is per capita income. So quickly let us see what are the concepts of national income. Concepts of national income are the formula of national income, then the features of national income, then importance of national income, then concepts of national income, that is GDP, monetary value of one country in 1 year, or final products of market value. NDP, GDP minus depreciation. Depreciation and machinery out of fashion or decrease in the value of assets is known as depreciation. Then GNP. GNP includes GDP plus net factor income from abroad. Then NNP is GNP minus depreciation is NNP. Then personal income, individual's total income, that is addition of all sources of income, minus undistributed corporate profits and profit taxes. Then disposable income, money ready to spend, that is personal income minus personal taxes or direct taxes. Then real income is exact monetary value. To compensate the rupee value, we apply the formula NNP into base year index divided by current year index. And who gives the indices every year?
RBI
index every year based on the rupee value percentages, it will change the indexes. Per capita income is total income divided by total population. So this is all about national income, Nana. Any doubts in this? Tomorrow we'll go with inflation and business cycle, which would be the two topics left over is inflation, money supply and inflation and business cycle. If we do these two concepts, that would be end of unit one. And until now, any doubts? No?
Clear, ma'am.
Yeah, so day after tomorrow, again at 9 o'clock. CS, please give me the numbers who have joined late so that we'll start the class by 9 from tomorrow, from day after tomorrow. Is it clear? So that's it for today. Meet you day after tomorrow. That's on Wednesday at 9 o'clock. Okay, ma'am.